by training, physiologist, biochemist. But now we're going to go on to the next one. Okay, we're going to talk about who lives in the soil, what they do, and how we can help them be nourished. That's how we're going to start. Then we're going to go on to how plants solve all your problems. We're going to talk about pasture. Do I say pâturage? We're going to talk about cover crops. And then I'm going to spend a lot of time on compagnon et culture de... Do you actually use this word? You do, okay. Just checking. we're going to talk a lot about how to grow crops together. And I think that works for vegetables as well. I work with one of the largest vegetable producers in the state of Washington, with onions, les oignons, des courgettes. I don't know asparagus.
Asperge.
Pomme de terre. Blé. No maïs, but that's pretty much what we do. And we work mostly with companions, so we're growing things together in those fields. We're using cover crops in the off season. In the asperge, last year we did 15 tons. And we had 20 hectares, so 20 hectares, with intercropping to keep it covered. So I think we do okay. And this is organic. So, and organic is biologique. Okay, and lastly, we're going to talk about how to measure, because everybody always asks me, how do we measure? How do I know? We're going to talk about the new measurement for soil organic carbon. And I'm going to say here that everything I'm going to talk about are things that you can use as a farmer. These are not tools that are really fancy. These are tools that are meant to be used by farmers on your farm to measure your own quality, to measure microbial biomass. This one, we're adapting. It's still expensive, but to measure the density of minerals, it's kind of expensive. It's not that easy, so we're working with groups. So today, à travers le tout de verre, down the wormhole. And I gave everybody my card, but if you don't have it, this is my email. You're welcome to send me questions. If you want, the website is rhizoterra.com. We have various bits of information there. I encourage you to tweet. I've been tweeting all day today, so I encourage you, if you like to tweet, go for it. I didn't translate this slide because I think that what's really important here is that we understand that everything is happening in this part of our soil. So somewhere around 25 centimeters. 25 centimeters. This is from North Dakota, one of the coldest places on Earth. Never go there. It's terrible. It's very close to Winnipeg, Manitoba, in Canada, which is also very terrible. But you can see these were beside each other, and you can see the soil on the snow here, and you can see nothing here. We need to prevent erosion, whether it's water erosion or wind erosion. This is on my farm. And you can see that we, in this case, the crop died. This is causa d'hiver. And causa d'hiver, pas de culture couverture, right? Cover crop. And this one had a companion crop. So in this case, we had a winter a companion crop in the winter canola. In this case, we did not. And you can see the difference in the water. It's accumulating in one place and not in the other. Part of the reason for this is that some of this is still alive. And when you have organic matter, it holds the water. And we are in a 300 millimeter rainfall zone. So we need to hold all the water that we can. It's very dry. Soils should look like this. We should see the roots. We should see very good aggregates, vers de terre. We should see a profile like this. You're not going to see these except in these beautiful photos that I have. There's 14, so 14 acorine, yeah, de acorine, on the head of a pin, so they're very small. This is, I don't even know how to say that in French, 50,000 times magnification. It's really big. Yeah, okay. Merci. The one thing that I want you to take away from today is that soil is a habitat. Okay, so don't think about your soil as something to grow things in. It is, but it's more important that it's a habitat for all the things that live inside your soil. So the mites, the calendula, the protozoa, the nematodes, all of that, it's really important. The other thing is the really good thing about it is that we, as farmers, can modify the habitat if we want. We can make it better, we can make it worse. We can adapt it so that it does things for weeds and insects, or we cannot. It's completely up to us. More of these beautiful mites. Now, many of you are vegetable farmers. So that wave up here looks just like a moldboard plow. So when you're plowing the soil, even when we're digging potatoes, we're digging vegetables, carrots, and things like that, we are disturbing the infrastructure of the soil. And we're breaking it up and turning it into a mess. It takes a lot of energy to rebuild, a lot of energy. And so what we want to do is do everything we can to not have to use so much energy to rebuild our soils. We don't want these organisms to be so tired they can't rebuild. So we need to help them. So this is what we need to work on. Okay, the most important, if you think of nothing else, the most important characteristic of a healthy soil is the structure. It's only the structure. No, it's okay. And the really good news about the structure is that plants will build structure and they'll take it down. So some plants will build it a lot, and some plants like peas, pois, des pois, des haricots, I guess those are the two big ones. They make the soil very soft, very light. Mice will make it very hard. alfalfa, lucerne, will make it very hard. But plants do that, and they do it for their own reasons. So they are creating soil structure that helps them. And this is it. They're creating an infrastructure. Plants are creating an infrastructure. The organisms that work or live around the plants are creating this amazing infrastructure. Okay.
Ça va pour tout le monde au niveau de la compréhension. Surtout, n'hésitez pas, hein, s'il y a quelque chose qui vous bloque, une phrase que vous n'avez pas compris, qui vous semble importante, manifestez-vous.
OK. Compaction is a really, you can see the layer here. And here, this is in Denmark. You can see after 5 years of no-till, we have a little bit here, but nothing much. It's starting to break down. This is in bananas. That's ananas? Ananas, yeah. And you can see we have a big layer here. That's a problem. That's because of too much potassium and too much chloride, making the soil very hard at that level. This is what I mean by structure. It should look, see, it looks like a map, right? This is what the infrastructure is about. You have the bacteria, the protozoa, everything moving on these roads, moving between these particles, moving in here. We need the structure in order to have animals eating so that the fauna can eat the microbes. We have to have the predators eating the prey. If we don't have predators eating the prey, then we don't have recycling of nutrients. If you build it, and this is a cover crop, and this is seeding directly into a green cover crop. We do this all the time. So we're not killing it until afterwards. So we leave it green, we seed into it, because it's much easier, right? It's easier to cut a green plant than it is to cut a dry plant. So we cut directly into the green, and then we kill the crop. And some people will have on the front of the tractor crimper roller, like there'll be crimper rolling, and then seeding behind. Other people are spraying the crop out afterwards. And they do come. And you can see the earthworm tunnels here. And our goal as farmers needs to be able to build the soil as deep as possible. I don't want it here, I want it all the way down. I want to create soil so deep, deep like in the Ukraine. We had talked today about litter bags. We use this a lot. It's this hashtag soil your undies. It's fun for the public. So if you have people coming onto your farm, it's much more fun for them to see it. This is a real test, though everybody thinks it's funny, but it's fun, but it's actually a real test. So only fungi can break up cellulose, which is cotton. So it's a measure of fungal activity to bury cotton strips. You don't have to bury underwear. You can bury bits of cloth that are 100% cotton. And you bury them, and I have on my website, you'll find a method for how you do this with strips so that you can measure the amount of biological activity you have in your soil. It's very simple, and it's very accurate. It was developed in the early 1900s in Britain, and this is just a new take on an old test, but it works very well. It's demonstrates things really, really well. Don't use women's underwear. It, even though it says it's 100% cotton, it's not. You can bury them for any length of time you want. So that's the beauty of it. You can actually do a whole experiment where you do 3 weeks, 2 weeks, you know, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, and
there are not norm to compare with.
Yeah. You, no. Well, no. But you can compare yourself. So, if we go back, so with this one. This one was from a conventional farm, and these were both left for 2 months. And this one was after a cover crop. And we see this. This is one of the best demonstrations for most people to say, oh, this what you're doing works. So this is always what we're going to be thinking of today, always. The biology is at the top, the chemical and the physical are at the sides, because the biology unites the chemical and the physical properties of the soil. Without them, we don't have soil. Soil productivity is about nutrition, it's about density. Because if we push all the nutrients into the food, we don't have this. We don't have a problem with this. We have excellent environmental quality. And in the end, it's about the health of everything. Biodiversity. These are bacteria. There's lots of diversity in your soil. It's for you to make a habitat for it to grow. And the one way we do this is with plants. The most active biological part of your soil are the roots. So when we think about soils, and I was thinking about this from the French perspective, because sol is masculine, I think it should be feminine. And the reason for that, it's just my thinking of that when I was writing it down, because I kept writing it in a feminine form, because that's for me. And I was thinking, because it's really the mother of all agriculture. But this is kind of a mirror to the below ground, because the more we can put in the above ground, the more diversity we have in the microbiology and the microfauna and all of that below ground. So let's get to the root of the problem. This is David Brandt. He's quite a famous farmer from Ohio in the U.S. He really pioneered the use of daikon radish. Radis. You can see it here. Using it as a cover crop to open the soil and to break down compaction. This is the rhizosphere. So this is another term we're going to talk about today. So the rhizosphere is the root, racine. The soil attached to the root, and the soil that is influenced by the root, because the root leaks. The root leaks exudates, it leaks nutrients, it leaks water, but it also takes in water and it also takes in nutrients. So the one thing I'm going to say here is that seed quality is really important, because the nutrients that are in the seed are what makes that plant. And it makes it healthy, and it drives everything you have to the very end. So if you put a really good seed in really bad soil, that seed will leak, will actually take nutrients away from itself in order to exchange for things it needs. So it will push things out into the soil, and then it will take other things back in. And we don't want that. We never want the seed to give up anything that it doesn't have to. We want the seed to hold everything, grow this amazing plant. So we need to make sure that when we are growing, when we first have a seed in the ground, that that soil is amazing. We have plants trying to make more roots. So we have microorganisms that will give off chemicals that make the plant want to make more roots. And we have diseases that are trying to make the plant slow down. So diseases actually are most disease organisms are very poor competitors. They're really bad competitors. They can't get on the root. If the root's growing in great soil, it's growing fast, then they can't get on. So they try and slow it down. So everybody thinks about plants and soils as being not very dynamic, but there is a lot of talking going on below ground, a lot of communicating. There are plants sending signals, there are organisms sending signals. They're all talking below ground, deciding on what's going to happen next. And the biggest thing is, so you've heard a lot about carbon. Root exudates are the most available form of carbon in the soil. That's why roots are the most important part of the soil. And then we have the organic matter, we have the dead plant material, but the most important thing of everything is the actual root exudates itself. And every different plant you put in the ground, every different one, exudes its own signature, its own unique soup of exudates. No plant exudes the same exudates. So that's why diversity works, is because the more different plants I have in the ground, the more different exudates I have, the more organisms I can grow. Food webs. So soil carbon from roots. I thought I did this one, but I didn't. So all the carbon that comes out of the roots is also more stable, so it builds a more stable aggregate environment. So you're building soil structure. The stuff that comes from the surface, the residues in that, they don't build soils like roots do. And what is the most available form of organic material in your soil? Old roots and root exudates. So if we want to build soils and organic soils, we have to put roots in the ground. We have to put shallow roots, we have to put medium roots, and we have to put deep roots. So the rhizosphere is the plant, the soils, and the organisms working together. And this is what it looks like. You should see the soil attached to the roots. You should see it attached right on. You should never see a bare root. If you pull a bare root out of the ground, you have work to do. This is Bacillus thuringiensis, or BT, BT. These crystals here, they are the active ingredient that kills insects.
Les petits blancs, c'est des réservoirs de molécules qui vont avoir une activité insecticide.
Merci. And bacteria, and you can see, they leak. So they have exudates as well as the roots, and they start to build the soil structure.
En fait, on est sur des structures de bactéries qui vont s'agglomérer, qui vont aussi du coup avoir des exudats qui vont contribuer à construire le sol.
And with the fungi, you have the hyphae. I think you call them hyphae, too. I think you do. Yeah? Okay. The hyphae make like a net. So they make more aggregates. So now we have the bacteria making aggregates, we have the fungi making aggregates, we're having better soil structure. When you see this, you know you're doing really well. So when you go into your field, if you see the champignon, you can go, yeah, I've done a good job. I'm getting there. Because now you're breaking down the really hard residues. You're growing mice. Then if you're growing mice, then you are going to have, you want to have the fungi growing on top so that you're breaking it down so the nutrients are being made available into the soil.
We see trees on the field sometimes, and is it a problem for the future if trees will grow?
Oh, trees!
A small tree.
Okay. Well, so if we fly over France, like I did, you see that most of France was forest. A lot of France was forest, so you see the trees. But are you talking about mushrooms, like champignons?
No,
trees, like agar. Yeah, with the trees, yeah, you're reclaiming the soil from the trees. When you have trees, it means that you need to use more moisture. Okay, I'll explain it again. When you start seeing trees, these arbor, in your fields, you have too much available water.
Trop d'eau.
Yeah. And which means that you need to pump more water out. So then you look for tournesol. Okay, and with tournesol, I'm going to grow fava beans. I think you call them fava. And maybe clover as well in between. So I'm going to pump water.
Just ask a question for the mushrooms. It doesn't matter which one?
No, it doesn't matter which one. I mean, unless you want to grow mushrooms to eat.
No. If we walk around in the field and we see mushrooms, doesn't matter which one.
That's correct.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes, you're right, yes. These are mycorrhizae. Mycorrhiza are what hold everything together. So here is the mycorrhiza here. There's a spore there. And this is sand. So it's holding it all together. But you can also see there are spaces for everything to move around, for air, for water, for organisms to move. You can see it here too. See them holding the sand? People go, oh, I have sandy soil, it's terrible. When you get mycorrhiza in your sandy soils, you start to hold them together. This is a rotation. This is, do you know melilo? Mm-hmm. It's sweet clover? Yellow? Yeah, I think so. Okay, play melilo. This is it. This is fallow and bare ground.
Yeah. Yeah. So I have the same translation. Jachère is not a. When you say jachère, it's a mixture of plants you have.
Oh. Okay.
I have this problem also.
Yeah, because I looked it up even in Frederick's book, and it's jachère.
Yeah, but jachère is when you have plants on it.
Okay.
And what you mean is when there is not.
Yeah. So how would I say that?
Non, rien du tout.
Bare soil.
C'est quand il y a pas de plantes du tout.
Okay. Yeah, okay, bare soil. This is bare soil. And then we have, like more in here. This is organic. And these ones are, this is organic. So organic, and not organic. So, and not organic. And we, this one here, we, but all with no-till. So with no plowing, all non-livo. And what we see is that when we have legumes in the rotation, we actually start to have more mycorrhizal activity. So this is about your rotation. Very important to pay attention to the rotation. Protozoa need structure in order to move around the soil. They need a lot of soil structure because they can't move, they don't burrow. So they have to move around in the infrastructure to get to the bacteria. We must get to bacteria. We need to eat a lot of bacteria because bacteria, the more microbes that you get in the soil, the more carbon and nitrogen they'll consume. And if we don't have predators, then they won't recycle. And it's the recycling that's really important. We need predators. We need to eat them up. So when you do no-till, so not, it's non-libéral, right? No-till? Non-libéral?
Sans
travail. Or sans travail, okay. It means that you're going to have more soil animals. Everybody talks about microbes, microbial this, microbial that, but nothing happens in the soil without animals. If we had only microbes, then the plants would starve, because microbes can grow a new generation every 24 hours, every day. They grow a new generation. They can starve plants. If we have predators, there's no starving plants, and we recycle. And look, I mean, look at this moth. That's going to eat everything. It's a predator, and a really good one. And these animals are eating up organic matter, they're eating up each other, and we need this in order to recycle, and I can't emphasize this enough. The reason that we don't do a lot of soil disturbance is because we don't want to destroy the animals. The bacteria and the fungi will come back, but the animals will not. So we need to use cover crops, use companion crops, use these other tools in order to maintain the animals. This is colembola. Colembola are insects. They're related to insects. So insecticides will kill them. And if I could do anything, I would rid the world of insecticides. But I'm working on it. But these are really important for eating up the surface material, for holding the litter to the ground. And in the water, they do things like this. They form rafts so that they can survive inundation. These are incutraids. They are petit vers de terre. And they are excellent indicators of soil quality. They are also very good at concentrating nutrients around the plant roots. And they're called incutraids all over the world. Sometimes they're called potworms, but I think that's a Latin name. It's the only name that I actually know for them. These are middens of Velcutera, and you can count them, and that's an indicator of soil quality. You can count them. So if you have, and here in France, you have a lot of Lumbricus terrestris. I saw Marcel Boucher today. He loves Lumbricus terrestris. Lumbricus terrestris, you have a lot if you count the middens, that can be an indicator of soil quality too. You can count earthworms. So you can put a shovel in the ground, flip it over, count the number of earthworms. If you have, in one shovel, if you have six, come to six, okay, comes on. If you have 10, pretty good. If you have more than 10, you're doing very well.
In which quantity of soil do you count it?
You count it in the shovelful. So when you take the spade, you flip it over, and it's just in one shovelful, okay? And everybody always asks me about earthworm sex. This is earthworm sex, just to wake everyone up. You say sex, and they all go, and the results. This is a cocoon. Cocoons can have 1 to 5 babies in them. And you can build earthworms really quickly in your soil, and I'll show you that. This is an earthworm emerging from a cocoon. And then they do rest. Earthworms sleep. They sleep when it's too hot. They sleep when it's too dry. They sleep when it's too cold. But they like it cold and wet. So cool, wet soils will always have more earthworms. How do we get cool, wet soils? Cover. Cover, cover, cover. That makes cooler soils, and there's a number of reasons why we want cooler soils. Decomposition, without no animals, with the fauna. If we want to break things down, we need the fauna, and I'll show you why. So this is earthworms. We have trois vers de terre dans le sol. This is hay.
Foie.
This is hay, and then we have corn in there. Mice. We have trois semaines, trois vers de terre, and we have nothing. Nothing left. They ate it all. If you want, you have to feed the animals in the soil. You have to feed them, and you have to feed them a lot. Earthworms really like, earthworms and all soil animals love muta, and they love polza. They like them both. Anything that's a brassica, cauliflower, it's cruciferae, but broccoli, they love it. They will grow a lot in there. Radishes, they love old radishes. Earthworms are, I think I have that in there. Earthworms are like a big vacuum tube. So they suck. Essentially what they do is they suck in one side and then push out the other. So it's just like, out it comes. There's no teeth. They're not chewy. Yeah, just sucking. So, another one. This is how to build earthworms, because earthworms are going to be make the biggest difference in your soil. So here we have a density, this is an equivalent density of 80 vers de terre, zero. This is colza, and you can see the earthworms love it. Blay. You can't tell the difference. But there's earthworms in one side. Lin. Flax. They love flax. Earthworms have one neuron for a brain, only one, but they know what's good for them, and they'll eat it. And if you grow it, they will eat it, and they will multiply very quickly. And what we see, this is plowed. We have a mulch, This is direct seeded, and this is pasture. These are all the different species of earthworms here. And you can see that when we have a pasture and we put, which is like a cover crop, anything that we leave for a length of time, we can build diversity. And it's the same everywhere, and we saw it today in the data from Nicolas, that when you plow, you have fewer earthworms. It's just the way it is. Soil animals do not like plowing. Macrofauna, they eat, they mix the organic matter, they stimulate biological activity, you get a whole lot more nutrition, they recycle nitrogen and carbon, and they make big pores that create better aeration and better water. And if you don't have soil animals, and I'll say it again and again and again, you will not have good soil structure, you will not have recycling. You need to have the whole thing. You need to have the bacteria and the fungi to feed the fauna, and the cycle cycles all the nutrients. And you need the plants to feed it all. So plants feeding microbes, microbes feeding the fauna, and that creates the whole cycle. So, in healthy soils, the plants look wonderful, and every farmer can walk in a field and know if there's something wrong. You all can do it. You walk in the field and you go, oh, there's something not right here. It's okay to just do that. You want to have good soil structure, and then you have all these services, including this, because we hear a lot of talk in Europe about glyphosate. We don't have a problem with glyphosate when we have healthy soils. Because with healthy soils, we have a lot of organic matter, we have a lot of humic acids, and humic acids bind glyphosate and take it out of the system and allow it to be digested by bacteria. So we want to have this service. This is a really important service. We have a lot of diversity, and we have diversity of plants. We want our wheat in, this is my farm, and this was one of my particularly good wheat crops that we grew on, how much was that, 16 inches of water. So that's 36 centimeters of water. You get way more than that. So, when you're standing on the ground, I want you to think about the fact that you're standing on a habitat. Okay, so now, we're going to take a little break. I'm going to move on. Same thing. So we're reminded of the model review. This is also review. Okay. I'm going to let everybody read this.
Just one question. There, when you say jachère organisée,
I know.
Bare soil?
It's bare soil. Yeah, every time you see jachère, it's wrong.
Okay. À chaque fois que vous voyez jachère, c'est sol nu. C'est pas jachère comme nous on utilise le mot jachère.
Yeah.
C'est sol nu.
I use the wrong word. Every time, it's consistent. I did the wrong thing every time.
No, it happened to me also. It's
okay.
Just so everyone.
Yeah. So, in France right now, there's a big as everywhere in the world. There's a big discussion right now about carbon, about storing carbon. And when you fly over France, you notice that there's a lot of bare ground right now. There doesn't have to be. And if there weren't, people would be storing carbon. The other thing in this about storing carbon is that if you leave the ground bare, you use up the carbon, and you use up the nitrogen, and you use up all the other micronutrients because the microorganisms are still working. So they're still using it up. And that's what this is about. Everybody thinks when they meet the ground bare that they're resting. Everything is resting. It's not resting at all. It's starving. And it's using up what's there because they're starving. So, you know, think of it like that.
Okay, donc en fait, ce qu'elle dit, c'est que là, on parle beaucoup de stockage de carbone, mais dès qu'il y a un sol nu, non seulement on ne stocke pas de carbone, mais en plus on déstocke car la vie du sol continue à fonctionner, continue à puiser dedans pour ne pas mourir de faim.
Okay. I think the other thing that's important here for me is that we have to optimize the surfaces in the soil, and we do that by having cover crops and by having covers on the soil. So that's what that's about.
C'est pour ça qu'on cherche à avoir les cultures intercalaires et les couverts végétaux vivants.
And this is just, if you want to look at roots, you need to get into the soil and look at them. This is the German National Field Day that's going to happen this June. And it's a wonderful place to go. You get to look at lots of roots.
Donc du coup, pour regarder les racines, il faut aller voir le sol, et ça se passe en Allemagne, et c'est le journée du sol, et c'est en façon jeune.
And again, it's all about the roots. The roots are going to feed the soil, so we're feeding the soil with the roots and with the root exudates. Now, this one is interesting.
C'est très intéressant. See these, the racines jaunes.
I don't know if you can see it, but
they are quite yellow.
The mycorrhiza, when you see yellow roots, it means that they have mycorrhiza. You can't see mycorrhiza without a microscope, but you can in certain plants like maize, sorghum, and onions. And when they're colonized by mycorrhiza, they have a yellow color.
Sur certaines plantes, on peut observer l'arrivée des mycorhizes avec la couleur sur le maïs, les oignons et je crois le sorgho.
And you can see that this is actually mining this old root or this old piece of organic matter.
Du coup, là, c'est utilisé de façon moins
énergétique. So these are spores of the mycorrhiza, and you can see that the mycorrhiza actually form reproductive structures, and this says it all here, forms reproductive structures before the plant starts flowering. And the reason for that is that it can't disrupt the plant, because the plant is its host, and it can't grow without a host. So it needs the plant to grow really well, so it will flower itself before the plant does.
Et du coup, la symbiose va jusqu'au fait où il y a étalage des productions de semences entre la plante et le champignon pour pas avoir de concurrence.
And mycorrhizal fungi, they make the plant have more chlorophyll. They make the plant, and that's really important because chlorophyll converts to amino acids, which is the building blocks of proteins in the plant. So you want more, and more vitamins. The mycorrhizae are going to help with the absorption of these nutrients, as well as many others. They're going to increase the plant's resistance. They're going to determine the microbial community in the rhizosphere. They're going to also help with the fertilization and the uptake of phosphorus and zinc. And legumes, they also need to, they absolutely need phosphorus and zinc and iron in order to fix nitrogen.
Right.
Yeah, it's pretty straightforward. And we saw this one before, so I'm not going to use that one now. Okay. So, absorption of plant nutrient. This is really important because plants, as you can see, produce a lot of different things. So, they produce carboxylates in order to make phosphorus available. They use siderophores to also grab onto iron and zinc. The mycorrhiza are really, well, we know they're really important. And a combination of all of this is why we need to have a whole bunch of plants growing together. So, pour que la biodiversité?
Oui. Il y a besoin de traduction de vocabulaire scientifique. Ça passe. Les caladeurs, tout ça, ça est clair pour tout le monde. Non, en fait, du coup, c'est les différents. Ça va aider à récupérer tous les différents minéraux tous les différents minéraux et ions dans le sol. Ça va aider à avoir une bonne absorption et une bonne un bon site dispatchage des minéraux.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And this is wrong, this should be févrole. Févrole, soja, that's French, that's not French, that's Spanish, soja, and maïs. The color is the pH, and you can see that maïs is exuding compounds at a higher pH. Soya, somewhere in here, and févrole down here. This actually tells us a lot about it tells us a lot about what the plant needs. So that in this case, this plant is trying to get phosphorus and zinc and iron. Probably magnesium as well. This one, because it's more neutral, is taking up everything kind of the same. This one really only wants one or two things. Nitrate.
En fait, du coup, on voit que les plantes vont faire des exudats, des sécrétions à différents pH, et ça va nous indiquer quels minéraux vont avoir besoin. Du coup, la févrole et le soja vont avoir besoin de phosphore,
I'm trying to find my notes. I have my notes on these, but and this is, we're going to talk a lot about intercropping, culture interclare, and so what we know is that root exudates have the phosphatases. You see all of them here. And so, for example, we talked about this with the pois chiches and blé. We know that they actually work together to make phosphorus available. And I think this is self-explanatory. The most important thing here is this. That plants are helping each other. So when we grow plants together, or we grow them in a cover crop, they actually are helping each other, and it depends on what we pick.
Du coup, en fait, on voit que c'est pas des, enfin, que les plantes ont vraiment travaillé ensemble. C'est pas du 1 plus 1 égale 2, c'est du 1 plus 1 égale 3. On est sur la synergie, pas sur.
Yeah, the synergy.
Là, c'est en travaux de combien d'années? Pour avoir une idée, le 16%, il a été considéré pendant combien de temps?
Oui.
Mais pour combien de temps il a eu laissé?
Oh, I see it. It's mixed up.
Les communautés ont augmenté de 16% la production des enzymes clés par rapport aux bactéries.
Yeah, so that means that, so I'll explain. That means that the species mix, like when we put the species together,
yeah,
that they create an environment, yeah, there where we increase the production of the phosphatases by 16%.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah. But this test was just 1 year, 5 years, or 10 years?
Oh, this was over 4 years.
Okay, good.
I have one question. In this test, did they also look at, I guess they tried different mixtures? Are there some?
They didn't. They just reported on this particular mix.
Oh, okay. So
we're going to see some other mixes.
Oh, okay.
But to go to your question, chickpeas, so quashish. Sounds like hashish. Maybe we need some. There's two kinds, the kabuli, and I think it's the same in French. They're the larger seeds, and then there are the desis, and they have a smaller leaf. They're smaller. We have two kinds in North America that we grow. The desis are wild type, which means that they form more mycorrhiza. And then you can explain this to everybody after, okay? They form more mycorrhiza, so they're more mycorrhizal. They leak a lot of acids out of their roots. So they make a lot of things that are bound to calcium available in the soil. So if you have soils that have a lot of calcium in them, they're really good at making calcium available to all the other plants, and magnesium and things like that. So they're really, I like growing chickpeas together with things.
Yeah, no, my question is it possible that, we all agree that you need diversity, but is it possible that if you put two plants together or three, you will have the other way around, that they block each other? That
yes, you can.
But we don't really know yet how...
We know a lot. I'm going to show you a lot of plants that grow together. And I'm going to tell you some of the ones that don't grow together.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And because some plants are synergistic, mm-hmm. and sometimes they are not.
Mm-hmm.
So sometimes 1 + 1 = 4 and 5.
Yeah.
And sometimes 1 + 1 = big 0.
Elle a expliqué très rapidement sur les pois chiches qu'il y avait donc deux espèces différentes. Une a priori, moi je ne me connais pas, je ne sais pas. Une a priori qui serait sauvage et l'autre non. Et la sauvage, en fait, elle est beaucoup plus intéressante parce qu'elle va avoir un taux de mycorhization beaucoup plus élevé et elle va libérer des exudats en quantité beaucoup plus importante, pour libérer par exemple du calcium en quantité beaucoup plus importante. Donc c'est extrêmement intéressant. Et elle disait que du coup elle aimait beaucoup mettre des pois chiches en fait en combinaison parce que justement ça va libérer beaucoup de nutriments et beaucoup de calcium. Et moi ma question c'était est-ce que vous pouvez être tous d'accord que la diversité c'est important, mais est-ce qu'on peut mettre des plantes ensemble qui vont se bloquer plutôt que de libérer plus comme on le veut. Et donc elle a dit que oui, que c'était possible et qu'elle allait nous montrer après des mélanges à partir.
Okay, so this is just a quote from William Albrecht. I think it's important because we have to think about phosphorus as an organic nutrient and not an inorganic nutrient. So that's the only thing I'm going to say about that. This is another reason why we need to have plants mixed together. And we need dicotyledons mixed with monocotyledons because they do very different things. They do very different things. And so we need them mixed together so that we are getting all the nutrients that we need. So if we, for example, sarrasin, lupin, colzin, all of them change the pH of the rhizosphere. They're well known for it. They all change it because they're trying to change the solubility of the nutrients so they can have them for themselves. So what we want to do is we want to mix plants together in order to get all the nutrients. So for example, if we want to get calcium and phosphorus, calcium, phosphor, magnesium. Then we grow sarrazin. And that makes it organic. So the plants take up the inorganic form of those nutrients and then they make it organic. Colza, so your canola or your rapeseed rocks, you'll get, they also will take up phosphorus and calcium by making the soil of a lower pH. Lupin does something really interesting. And we're going to do charades.
Peut-être traduire ce qu'il a mémorisé.
Pour moi, ce qu'elle a dit, c'est que le sarrasin, le lupin et le colza sont des plantes qui vont pareil modifier la disponibilité des minéraux dans le sol et donc diminuer l'influence du pH sur la capacité à faire pousser les plantes. Le sarrasin va permettre de rendre le magnésium disponible et le colza pour tout ce qui est phosphore et calcium. Et elle va parler du lupin qui est apparemment très intéressant.
Gacidifier la rhizosphère.
Pour préciser, le CEC, c'est la capacité d'échange cationique d'un sol. En gros, simple, c'est la capacité du sol à transformer rapidement la matière organique pour les données, comme un gros frigo américain ou pas. Et en fait, vous savoir que dans le sol, ce qui stabilise aussi le sol, c'est un complexe archéologique. C'est un peu la liaison entre les particules minérales et organiques. En fait, c'est le fer qui contient tout ça. Et le fer, dedans, c'est aussi important, c'est d'avoir une liaison calcium-magnésium.
C'est quoi les trois premiers mots du cotylédone?
Le cotylédone, c'est au niveau botanique, c'est le fait que tu as les plantes monocotylédones et dicotylédones. Et en fait, tout ce qui va être monocotylédone, par exemple, c'est les deux plantes des céréales. C'est au niveau de l'histoire botanique des plantes, l'évolution, c'est le premier à avoir apparu. Après, tu auras les deux cotylédons, c'est les premières vraies feuilles qui sortent. Quand tu fais un haricot, par exemple, les deux petites feuilles. Okay. Ça, c'est les réserves, c'est les fausses premières feuilles. C'est dans l'évolution, elles sont arrivées après, c'est quand tu évolues.
D'accord.
C'est juste la force. Hein.
Ok, so with lupin, when phosphorus and calcium, and then you have. And calcium sulfate, when you have these. And it can't get them. They're not available. It makes a lot of roots at this level. And it does that and then it pulses carboxylic acids out of its roots so that it breaks these and it can take them up.
En fait, du coup, le lupin, il exude beaucoup d'acide carboxylique qui va permettre de dégrader certaines molécules. Donc, du coup, c'est du sulfobe ou des molécules un peu complexes et qui vont permettre de récupérer le calcium et d'autres choses qui n'étaient pas disponibles avant.
Yep. Okay. Oh, this is. Do I not have the right one? Okay. So I think. This is, I think everybody knows these, but I'll go avoine, orange, maïs, tournesol, haricot, pois, radis, lupin, and trèfle blanc. The blue, c'est nitrate, azote. It can't be azote's nitrogen. Nitrate is
nitrite.
Okay. Le vert,
acide amine.
Okay. Acide amine. Okay, and junk is amides, and I think that's it. And the rouge, say oreides. What that means, simple nitrogen, more complex nitrogen, more complex nitrogen, very complex nitrogen.
Du coup, en fait, les différentes, ces différentes plantes vont produire différents types de complexité d'azote qui vont être plus ou moins disponibles. Les radis, ça produit l'azote qui est assez complexe, donc des acides aminés, c'est la base des protéines. Et ça va jusqu'à des, pour les pois, qui vont produire des molécules plus proches de l'urée qui vont être assez facilement disponibles et assez complexes.
And so, these are the ones, so haricots et pois, you put them in your cover crops. Because you protect the nitrogen.
Okay. Are there things with acidity of the soil?
Are there links? No, not really. These are the properties. I had to think about that for a minute. These are the properties of each of these plants. These what they normally do. So if your soil is more acidic, they're still going to leak these forms of nitrogen. If it's basic, they'll still exude those forms of nitrogen.
Because I have feed with a lot of with acid soil, mm-hmm. and I have a lot of white clover. Mm-hmm.
Well, you have a lot of white clover. Not just because you have acidic soil, but because you obviously have a lot of excess available nitrogen in that soil. And when you have acidic, and so, so I don't like white clover as a cover crop. I don't like it because it likes a lot of nitrate, like corn, like oats. Like corn, and so it competes. It uses the nitrate the same as the corn, the same as your crop. So I don't like having the white clover. I like other clovers better. Yeah. That's a complicated one. This is it's an important slide because you want these plants here, haricot, pois, radis, and lupin, you want them because they protect and they put nitrogen in an organic form.
Donc du coup, en fait, il y a des... Le trèfle blanc, elle n'aime pas trop en culture associée et en couverture. Ça fait une forme d'azote, le nitrate, qui ne va pas être très stable et qui va être en concurrence avec les céréales. La dite préférée, puisqu'il y a pois, haricots, radis et lupins qui vont faire des formes plus complexes d'azote, donc plus stables dans le sol et qui vont être des formes organiques, donc de cibles de disponibles.
Yeah.
Just to be sure that
when
you say that the white clover has a lot of nitrate in its air, so the nitrate is going out of the plant.
And into the plant. So it likes, what this really means is that it likes nitrates.
Okay, so it doesn't mean that it leaks a lot of nitrate that the other plants can lose.
It does, but it also takes it up that way. So it not only does it take it up that way, but it also leaks it out that way. So it means that if you have a plant that needs a lot of nitrate, like corn,
don't use white clover with it.
Yeah, don't use white clover with it because they're both using the same form. You want to use a different one, like lentils, lens. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you want to use lens. Yeah.
Okay.
J'ai une question sur la, ce qu'on a vu d'apporter des engrais minéraux sur les céréales, en général sur les cultures. Alors, on entend parler du glucide, des acides aminés. De nourrir les plantes avec des acides aminés, et qui, je crois qu'ils remplaceraient les engrais minéraux. qui viendrait en soit en complément ou soit. Alors j'ai pas d'infos, mais je, ça m'est venu aux oreilles. Je sais pas s'ils ont du recul là-dessus.
Amino acids make up about 2% of the nitrogen in your soil. De percent. Okay, not much. But plants and microorganisms preferentially take up amino acids compared to any of the other nitrogen forms.
Alors, elle a dit que dans le, en fait, dans le sol, l'azote est présent sous forme d'acide aminique à 2%, ce qui est très faible, sauf que les microorganismes des plantes en fait, préfèrent assimiler, enfin, utiliser de l'azote sous forme d'acide aminique, parce que ça leur permet d'avoir déjà cette forme-là dans la plante, plutôt que de prendre de l'azote et de devoir le transformer en acide aminique eux-mêmes. Du coup, c'est bien en fait, d'apporter directement l'acide aminique.
Sous quelle forme
sous
quelle forme ils apportent, je sais pas, est-ce qu'ils ont une méthode pour apporter ces acides aminés?
Do you have an experience on how to apply it?
You can, there are products that are like, there are products that are made from fermentation that you can use that have amino acids, a lot of amino acids in them. Does anybody here grow blueberries? Okay, because if you grow blueberries, amino acids are really important. Because, and the same with framboise. Framboise also, framboise. What other one? Currants, I don't know the word
cassis.
Same for cassis. If you're growing cassis, bleuet, framboise, then all of them need amino acid and you can, and you get it from fermentation.
En gros, donc pour répondre à la question, on peut acheter des acides aminés. Il y a des plantes qui existent sous la fermentation. Donc voilà, ça c'est comment les apporter.
No, they're it's not one. It's they like all of them.
Et on peut les déposer fermentés.
En gros, l'idée c'est de faire fermenter des fruits rouges.
Non.
Quel type de fermentation pour apporter ces acides aminés?
What fermentation?
Yes.
It would be we ferment. We do a fermentation with kelp, so seaweed. Kelp, and then we use a number, some minerals, and I mean, you really, and you're using bacteria because the bacteria, when you ferment, even if you make beer, it's the same thing. In fact, you could use beer on your soil to get amino acids. You could drink it and pour it.
En fait, si tu veux, l'idée c'est d'avoir un produit, quand tu fais fermenter un produit, il va produire des acides aminés.
N'importe quel produit.
Bah, par exemple, c'est pour ça qu'elle a pris l'exemple de la bière.
What product for you? En France, I don't know. Je ne sais pas pour la France. We make them in Utah, in the United States. We make products with amino acids in them for farmers that you buy in bulk as liquids. I don't know.
In France, I don't know. Can you make them? Pas des plantes riches en protéines qui font ça ou d'autres sortes de plantes, je ne sais pas.
Sorry, there's too much.
What kind of fermentation or production you could we could imagine to do here? What kind of plants?
How could you do it here? It's quite complicated, actually. You would have to. I don't think you could do it on your farm, unless you were a chemist.
Gayago is an enterprise which is producing stimulators, and they will produce amino acids also for the plants.
Can you tell that to everybody, please?
Gayago, it's an enterprise in France which is working with
us.
Gayago, c'est une entreprise qui travaille beaucoup actuellement sur les inhibiteurs, etc. Et apparemment, ils travaillent aussi avec Conrad Schreiber actuellement sur la formulation de préparation à base d'acinamine également.
Efficient microorganism solution, maybe, or
It's maybe. Possible.
Oh.
It's possible.
C'est possible avec les purins.
Avec les purins et les solutions de micro-organifications, tout ce qui est bocashi et tout ça, il y a moyen d'améliorer les fermentations et d'avoir une meilleure activité microbienne et beaucoup de fermentation dans le sol. Donc il y a moyen
d'améliorer.
J'ai encore une petite question. The soil you can drink the beer.
Yes.
How many hectolitres, right?
Okay. A dark beer, a stout, or Guinness. Guinness?
Guinness is good for
Guinness has a lot of amino acids. Guinness is a very good source of amino acids. So yes, you could pour Guinness on maybe a liter per hectare.
Okay.
I think it's better to drink the Guinness than to pour it on your own. Okay. This is onion, and I don't know sweet alyssum. Does anybody know the translation for sweet alyssum? This plant here. It's a flowering plant, I don't know, but we use it. We use onions and sweet alyssum. We use the onions for pollination, pollinators, and beneficial insects. It's low growing, grows about this high. Lots of flowers. It's very good for controlling thrips. I think you call them thrips here, on onions. And we use mixes, and you can see sorghum, moutarde, très spécial de moutarde caliente, very hot mustard, and two others. In this blend. This that you see here, this is mustard gas, because we're actually mowing this cover crop for control of nematodes.
Okay, alors en fait, plus ou moins, couverts complexes avec de la moutarde, du sorgho et d'autres choses. Et du coup, les gaz qu'on voit, c'est les émissions de gaz de la moutarde, donc c'est en train d'être tombé, d'être broyé.
It does. The mustards kill. However, so we know I had a graduate student at the university, at Washington State University, and he's published a paper on which cover crops, like which plant species, will affect, like kill certain nematode species, because they don't kill every one of them. So in this case, we are working on stubby roots nematodes. And we're working on root knot nematodes, but we're not working on the other ones. So we pick, this is a proprietary blend of mine that's for the control of two kinds of nematodes. We have other blends that we use on other nematodes so that we don't kill all of them. We only kill the ones that we want to kill.
La question c'était de savoir est-ce qu'ils n'ont pas peur en utilisant la montagne. En fait, là, ils utilisent la montagne pour toucher les nematodes. Et du coup, la question c'est est-ce qu'ils n'ont pas peur que ça tue tous les nématodes. Et a priori, elle a un étudiant qui avait fait une étude et donc publiée sur quels nématodes sont tués avec quelles espèces. Et donc là, en l'occurrence, ils utilisaient ce type de méthode pour. Deux nématodes en particulier pour gérer ces nématodes-là, mais ils ne savent pas forcément l'impact que ça doit avoir sur le reste des nématodes. Ils savent que ça va tuer ceux-là, mais pas forcément s'il y a un impact aussi sur le monde.
Yes, we can. It's up on my website.
C'est sur son site internet l'article.
It's by Patrick O'Neill. Okay, this is another reason for us to mix plants. This is water use. So, efficacité de l'utilisation de l'eau. And you can see we use a lot of water with soya. And here we have 14 species. And we use almost no water.
En fait, vous voyez qu'avec certains mélanges, avec un mélange de 14 espèces, elle utilise beaucoup, beaucoup, beaucoup moins d'eau que sur une monoculture. Et du coup, comment c'est possible qu'il y ait déjà la variation de consommation.
And so now we're going to talk a little bit about how that works. So we have lean, and we have lean sorgho. And you can see how the roots mix. And then you can see the roots mix are also mixing here. But what's really interesting is that when they mix together, we get a big increase in the flax, but we have smaller sorghum. So you asked me a question earlier, which plants are synergistic and which are not? Sorghum doesn't like cool season species. So it doesn't like, it likes cowpeas, it likes things that are tropical legumes.
Yeah.
Okay, sorgho and maize like tropical legumes. Wheat and cool season cereals like cool season legumes. And you can explain.
Du coup, elle dit là, du coup, elle a fait un essai avec une association de lin et de sorgho. En mélangeant les deux, le sorgho est 46% plus grand que tout seul, mais le lin est 46% plus grand que tout seul, et le sorgho, par contre, lui, va être le sorgho va être moins bon que lorsqu'il est tout seul, en monoculture. Et du coup, elle dit que tout ce qui est sorgho et culture. Tropical culture d'été vont apprécier les légumineuses d'été et tout ce qui est blé et les céréales d'hiver vont aimer les légumineuses d'hiver. Il n'y a pas les associations raisonnées que toutes les associations ne se trouvent pas les unes aux autres.
Parce que le sorgho, c'est une culture tropicale.
Oui, c'est ça.
Donc c'est pour ça.
Okay, so now we're going to talk about intercropping. And the Chinese started intercropping more than 1,000 years ago. Then the Iroquois Indians, the people of the First Nations of North America, they did the three sisters, which are maize, haricot, and courge. And then in the 1800s, in the United States, they showed that when you put trifa with maize, that they had more protein. And then in the early 1900s in Canada, they showed that, this is before fertilizer, so we have to make sure that we understand this. This is before we had fertilizers. We knew that if we mixed a mixed forage that had a legume in it, and then we grew wheat, that we got a 10% increase.
Donc elle a juste précisé que tous ces essais-là ont été faits il y a pas mal de temps, et du coup, c'était avant les engrais et les apports d'engrais chimiques.
So the point here is that this is not new.
No.
What we're talking about is really old. But what's old is new again. Okay, so what is a mixed crop? What are we doing here? In this case, this is sarrasin and triticale together, winter triticale, triticale d'hiver. And they're just mixed together. You sow it in the field. And so there are many different ways that we can do this, but the important thing is this is one, so winter triticale and sarrasin, they are compatible. We seed the winter triticale October, and then in avril, we seed the sarrasin.
Donc en fait, tu as dit que le sarrasin et le triticale d'hiver sont extrêmement compatibles, et que du coup, triticale se met en octobre et sarrasin se met en avril.
And the sarrasin is providing calcium, magnesium, and phosphor to the triticale. So in other words, and my sarrasin is supporting bees. So now I have another enterprise. I have bees, honey,
que du mead. Le sarrasin apportait, c'était une plante pénifère, et puis il y avait les abeilles qui arrivaient, qui étaient un produit en plus, et un bénéfice. Et il y avait aussi un adjoint de sarrasin qui rendait le magnésium disponible.
Il n'y a pas de problème de goûter à grain, par contre, est-ce qu'elle gère ça?
Do you have any problems with...
Comme ça, c'est court comme si...
Seeds. Plants will come to seeds.
We harvest both. So we... At the same time.
How do we do it?
Yeah, okay, so, and this is an important concept right now that we're going to talk about, and that is that if we're going to grow crops together, we have to separate them.
Yes.
Right? We have to separate them. So you need a seed cleaner. So sieves, where you sort them. The wheat in this one, let me go back. The triticale seed size is different from the sarrasin, so we can separate them. So when you grow crops together, there's two things you need to think about. One, they have to ripen together, so I can harvest them at the same time. And two, they have to be different seed sizes. So they tie, do you say taille de semis? Taille de semis has to be different. So you have to have different seed sizes. And then if you have different seed sizes, you can separate them, and they need to ripen together.
Donc ce qu'elle dit en fait, c'est quand on fait des cultures associées, il faut veiller à deux choses. C'est que petit 1, elles vont être récoltées en même temps, donc il faut avoir des dates de maturité similaires. Et il faut que les tailles de graines soient différentes pour pouvoir les séparer avec des tannins.
Okay, we're going to talk about this a bit more, so we're going to keep going. And So this is how it works. It's a mélange de racines. And you can see, this is important. Legumes, we put legumes, okay. We put legumes in because they do provide nitrogen at the same time to the plant, to our cash crop. So we don't wait for them to decompose and give us nitrogen. We grow them together so that they give us nitrogen. So the mycorrhiza are connecting all these plants together and they're sharing the nitrogen. They're sharing water and they're sharing nutrition.
Donc du coup, en fait, elle rappelle que les légumineuses relibèrent de l'azote dans le sol en même temps qu'elles poussent, donc il n'y a pas besoin d'avant qu'elles se décomposent, et que tout le système de mycorhize va permettre de redistribuer cet azote-là aux plantes voisines.
And then the other thing is that because I've got all these cash crops together, and I've got this cash crop, and I might have this one, I also reduce my insect pests, so I have fewer diseases, I have fewer weeds, I have fewer insects.
Et que du coup, avec ces cultures associées, il y a moins de problèmes d'insectes et de pression maladique.
This is peas, so pois et colza. So we're growing peas and canola together and we harvest them together. This is an amazing crop, amazing. The canola yields almost twice as much, and the peas yield twice as much as if they were by themselves.
Alors du coup, elle fait une association entre du pois et du colza. Elle dit que c'est une association qui est absolument fabuleuse car les deux plants doublent leur rendement si elles étaient en monoculture.
And these are some things that we've tried on the farm. So this is Axton Farm in Saskatchewan, Canada. And these are the things that he grows together. Okay, he does not grow a crop, a monocrop.
J'ai une question là sur cette photo. Est-ce que sur le type de mélange comme ça, les quantités de semences, c'est la dose en plein divisée par le nombre de variétés, ou comment elles laissent son petit mélange? Admettons une moutarde, on dit bah, c'est 10 kg en plein, on divise la dose en fonction du nombre de variétés qu'on met, donc là du coup, on
n'est pas à 5. What is the seeding rate, are my...
Yeah, do you add the quantity of seed, or do you put the quantity total and divide?
We sometimes, actually right now, we put them all together, mélange, and then seed.
Yeah, but is if you are seeding just canola, is 100 kilo per hectare.
Yeah, it's the same rate.
The same rate, so it's 100-100, it's not
half
and half.
Oh no, I wasn't meaning 50% of that. You use the full seeding rate of canola,
yeah.
You use the full seeding rate of peas.
Yes.
So
you do not divide by two.
Totalité de pois et totalité de canola. Et tu récoltes deux fois plus de chaque.
Wow. Because normally in the cover crop, when you are doing cover crop,
right, you would have it, but
you I don't know, 10 or 15.
Yeah, but this, we don't do that here. Because we're growing two crops together, full rate.
Full rate.
So the land equivalent ratio is 2.
Pardon me?
The land equivalent ratio is...
No, what it means is the yield. Yeah. So normally I would expect, let's say on canola...
It's like you put the same density of
canola. Yeah, I put the same density. And so, look, you can't see anything. This is a lot of plants.
Really
thick. I have no weeds. I have no diseases.
Yeah.
And I have no insect pests.
And also you have a fantastic amount of carbon.
I have a lot of carbon. I use a lot of CO2. I have a lot of nitrogen. There's just nothing wrong with that. Okay, and this is, just a second. So this is all you use. When you do this, It's the only input I have is energy and seed. Yes?
Just which type of seed of canola do you use? Hybrids or not?
We use all of it, so I'll go back. Some of it's Clearfield.
And what is Clearfield?
Clearfield is a non-transgenic canola. It's a special variety of canola that is bred for certain chemicals, but it's not a transgenic, so it's non-GMO, but it's still specific for one chemical. I don't think you have it here, but we can use any canola you want. I mean, it works on all of them.
Because that could be explaining the yield, because in France...
Go ahead, tell me.
Oui, colza févrole, il n'y a pas beaucoup de... Il n'y a pas plus de rendement chez nous. Enfin, moi j'en ai déjà fait.
Mais c'est du col.
Well,
I
think it's. I think if you're struggling with. I know some people don't struggle with canola, but here in France. But if you're struggling with canola, this is very nice.
Colza.
If you're struggling with colza, this is very nice because it, I mean, this mix works in Canada and it works in the southern United States.
Yeah.
It works in both places. We do it all over the place and it works in Germany. Works in Germany, works in Denmark. It should work here. And Finland. It works in Finland too. Yes.
Sorry. In the previous mix, all those mixed you harvest. So, or those mixed part of them are also
we harvest
every all of them.
Not this one. Oh no, we harvest this one too, because the chickling vetch right because we use it for seed. So for chickling vetch seed. So yes, we harvest all of those.
But as a cash crop,
yes,
that you will sell.
Tournesol for sale.
Yeah.
And hairy vetch for seed.
Okay.
Et du coup, tous ces mélanges de cultures-là sont récoltés, sont moissonnés.
Okay. This is flax and chickpeas together. In this one, we have the flax, and then we have the chickpeas. So we seeded them separately.
Et donc du coup, là, le lin et le pois chiche sont mis en alternance de rang et pas en mélange directement des.
And then you can see what it looks like here. And chickpeas can use a lot of fungicide, and we cut the fungicide rate down to 1/3.
Et du coup, le pois chiche qui est gourmand en fongicide normalement, là, on a réduit à un tiers
de... This is in Western Canada, so this is in Alberta, in Canada, Western Canada. And yeah, just amazing. And you can just see the trèfle here.
And you harvest the boss?
In this case, we thought that the fava beans, the favole, were just a companion.
Mm-hmm.
But it turned out we could harvest them. So we harvested the sunflowers, and then we harvested that. First, we harvest this, and then we harvested these. So we ended up with two crops.
How much is the space between the rows?
This was standard spacing on for sunflowers. So what is that? Is 30 centimeters? 30 centimeters, I think.
It depends. No, I don't think so. Maybe 30 inches.
No, 30 inches. Yes, sorry.
Yeah, because it depends.
Yeah, I was going to say no. Sorry, 30 centimeters. So these are 30-inch centers.
Yeah. 67 centimeters.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So the normal rate in Canada or United States also for corn.
Yeah. This is done with a planter, a corn planter. This is sarrasin and soya, and they were ripening together as well.
And do you reduce as nitrates?
We do. Because we don't see any need, like we don't use nitrogen. There's no azote.
So how much do you have?
We use, we're using inoculant. So they give inoculant on the beans, on the soya. And then we use nothing for the sarrasin. And we might put starter with like a beginning fertilizer, like a very small amount of fertilizer with the sarrasin, but just a little bit. Maybe some ammonium sulfate. And I will say, so when I seed these crops, I seed them with elemental sulfur. So I use 15 kilos to the hectare minimum of elemental sulfur. And I'm doing that because sulfur is one of the most important elements for plant defense. So if you want your plants to be able to defend themselves against diseases and insects, you must make sure that they have enough sulfur. And I use elemental sulfur because elemental sulfur builds the microorganisms that make sulfate. If I use sulfate, then I don't build the soil microorganisms. But if I use elemental sulfur, then I build the soil microorganisms that make sulfate.
Did you test the difference in the field with the
Yes. Mm-hmm. And the other thing is like here you have some what we call calcareous soils. You have a lot of calcareous soils in France. And elemental sulfur makes the calcium available, it makes the phosphorus available. It just works way better than thiosol or any of those other fertilizers. Yes, it is. Elemental sulfur can be used in organic farming.
Le soufre élémentaire, c'est utilisé chez nous aussi. Je ne sais pas si vous connaissez les gens. Ça existe en deux formes, en paillettes ou en compacté. Compacté et mélangé avec des bétonnées. Ça gonfle avec de l'eau et il se dépose, il est utilisé pratiquement sur toute l'année. Si vous apportez des cuisserettes, bah vous avez un pic de soufre qui monte et après ça descend tout doucement. Avec les soufres élémentaires, c'est vraiment une libération qui est pratiquement sur plusieurs mois. Ça veut dire qu'on n'a pas la même influence négative sur la biologie du sol comme avec les soufres élémentaires. Le soufre élémentaire, il est apporté sur des doses entre 40 et 60 kg à l'hectare. Et s'il y a 50 kg de soufre élémentaire qui est apporté, avec une contenance de 90% de S, ça veut dire qu'on apporte 45 kg de S, divisé par 2,7 pour arriver au SO3, ça fait un peu plus que 100 kg de SO3 qu'on peut apporter avec des glycérides, par exemple. C'est pas trop connu, mais ça existe en France aussi.
It's like super important. So this was, this is another experiment that was 4 years, where we're growing maize with févrole. And you can see, again, that maize and févrole like each other. Wheat and févrole, blé and févrole like each other. Orge. Orge and févrole. And in the end, it was what we see. This is proof that we have nitrogen flowing from the legume to the corn, to the maize. And now, And we're actually breeding. This is in Quebec, and we're actually breeding for intercropping. So we're breeding wheat for that. Yes.
The corn with the ferrole, mm-hmm. you don't seed them at the same time?
Yes, we seed them at the same time.
We seed them at the same time?
Yes. He's like, ah.
Jill, do you have some more experience intercropping corn with legume?
Yes, I'm going to show you that.
Okay, yeah.
I'm going to show you the maize in a minute. This is wheat and flax, which is also very good, and harvested together. And you can see this is harvesting. Here. And then you can see it. So this is what it looks like when it's harvested. This is at harvest. The other thing I'll say about this is that lin is a indeterminate plant, so it just keeps growing and growing and growing. But when it grows with wheat, it stops growing. So you can harvest it. It ripens and you can harvest it.
I'm sorry, when you breed wheat for intercalaries, what criteria do you look for?
Okay, so we'll go back. Okay, so the question was when we're breeding wheat, what are we looking for? You'll notice that we're growing, in this case, favorable in between the rows. We're looking for how competitive it is and whether they like each other. So that's what we're looking for. So we're looking for synergy. And this is how it works. So we have real evidence for the transportation of, in this case, we have peas and wheat. But you can see that we have, from the pea, we actually have the nitrogen from the pea going to the wheat. And this is really important, that it's providing 15% of the nitrogen to the cereal. I can grow wheat with no extra nitrogen by just using peas, lentils, lens, or chickpeas. I will show you fava beans. We just did that experiment this year. And I'll show it to you.
Elle disait qu'elle pouvait cultiver le blé sans un apport supplémentaire d'azote si elle l'associe à des légumes.
Qui sont en auto-fertilisés.
Oui. Oh, I don't have it. Oh, I lied. This year we grew fava beans, favoles with blé dur. And we made a mistake because we were trying it for the first time, so we did what you said. We had a full rate of wheat and we had a half rate of fava beans because we thought that the fava beans would just be a companion and provide nitrogen. We didn't think we'd harvest them. We made a mistake. And so this year we'll grow full rate wheat with full rate fava beans because on the Durham wheat, we had no diseases. We had really good protein, so it was excellent for pasta. And we had no diseases on the fava beans, like none. They were beautiful.
Ce qu'elle dit en fait, c'est qu'elle a fait une culture associée de févrole et de blé, et qu'elle avait fait l'erreur de mettre plein ratio de blé et seulement la moitié de la dose de févrole, et qu'au final c'était une erreur parce qu'elle a pu récolter la févrole. Qu'il n'y avait pas de maladie ni sur le blé ni sur la févrole et que le taux de protéines du blé était bien meilleur avec du blé dur et que du coup il était mieux valorisé pour les pâtes. Donc elle a refait la même association, mais avec plein ratio des deux.
And this just saying again, when you grow the legumes with your cereals of any kind, you get a really big bonus. So now we're going to go to pastures. And I said sursemi, but maybe it's, I don't know, it's seeding into the pasture. We call it pasture stitching, like a sewing machine. So this man is a dairy farmer. This is Simon, he's a dairy farmer. And he just went and got seed from the seed plant and he just threw it in the ground. It's a mix of a lot of things.
Donc la personne qu'on voit dessus, c'est un agriculteur laitier. Et en fait, c'est faire du semis direct dans la prairie.
And this is what it looked like under the mix. And this is what it looked like without the mix. Now, what's important here is that this happened in 18 months. 18 mois. We went from this to this.
Donc en fait, après la diversification de la pâture, on avait au début une pâture avec que du régras à droite, et 18 mois plus tard, après l'implantation de d'autres plantes, on a du coup un sol qui est plus... Enfin, à gauche, qui est plus...
This is Lilia Farms in Finland. And this is, now you can see the rows, but we're stitching, so we're sewing other plants into the rye for pasture. And I put this here, we've already talked about this, but how important soufre is for everything, for plant defense of insects and diseases. So now, this is the other one was Finland.
APS, Kinab, that was on the president's side. It's which APS is what? APS.
APS. Oh, APS. Okay, sorry. This is an enzyme for ATP sulfurase. So what we're doing here is, this is how we get to this amino acid here. And earlier on you asked me what amino acids do plants like. They like sulfur amino acids. They also like nitrogen amino acids.
Donc Bruno, en fait, tout à l'heure, je vais poser une question sur quel, vraiment quel acide aminé était aimé par les plantes, et cet acide aminé sulfuré. Et avec aussi de l'as, enfin, nitrogène, j'ai eu peur. Pas tous les acides aminés qui sont déjà.
So, all these different colors are different kinds of nematodes. So you asked me before, what nematodes are you working on? So over here, we seeded the pasture. We made better choices on the species, and we scheduled the irrigation better. And this one, we did the same thing, but we had bad choices. So we didn't get the pasture right. And so we still had a lot of plant parasites, since the green is plant parasites. And in this one, we had a lot of bacteriobores, so things that eat bacteria. So when we got it right, we started to cycle the nutrients because now the nematodes were eating a lot of bacteria. Over here, we just had a lot of bad things happening. So the important thing down here is that you have to get it right. It's not enough to do no-till. It's not enough to just do a cover crop. You need to find the right mix of things.
Donc ce qu'elle dit du coup, c'est que là c'est deux expériences avec à chaque fois des pâtures multi-espèces, mais en fonction de la rationalisation de l'arrosage et du choix des espèces, on ne va pas avoir les mêmes proportions de nématodes. Avec un choix raisonné, on va avoir plus de nématodes qui vont manger des bactéries ou qui vont restituer qui vont être bénéfiques à la vie du sol et pas des nématodes parasites des plantes. Donc on peut, c'est pas le tout de faire des mélanges, il faut rationaliser ces mélanges et trouver les bons mélanges et les bons systèmes de culture avec l'arrosage aussi.
So these are the total nematodes. You still see we had about 70% plant parasites here, but we had a lot of predators. We had a much better diversity where we had a horseradish cover crop. I don't know how to say horseradish.
Du radis fourrager peut-être.
Yeah, it's hot.
It's for eating.
Yeah,
it's eating for
like meat and things like that. Yeah,
For curves and everything, it's radish.
No, it's not.
C'est du blé for competence.
Ah, d'accord, peut-être.
Okay, before. Oh, okay, yeah. Fortified radish. And then, so you can see that what plants you pick make a difference. Okay. So we need to make sure, if we want plants to do special things for us, like to really make a difference, then we need to make sure that we have enough sulfur. We need to make sure we have enough micronutrients. If we don't have enough micronutrients and we don't have enough sulfur, then plants don't function the way we'd like them to have enough secondary plant metabolites to get to affect the insects and to affect the diseases.
Donc en fait, c'est pas le tout de mettre les bonnes plantes, il faut aussi donner les bons éléments aux plantes pour qu'elles puissent avoir un métabolisme qui fonctionne correctement et avoir les effets qu'on attendait.
So, compagnons et... So your companion crops can be a forage, or they can be a companion, or they can be both. In this case, we have a companion with colza d'hiver, and it was really a cover, because in winter, where we are, it gets really cold, and then it can get warm, and then it can get really cold again, and so the plants, we have trouble with winter canola. But when we grew a companion crop and we kept the snow cover and on the plants, then we actually had 50% better survival. So it worked. We still have, I haven't got it right yet, but it worked.
Donc avec des cultures associées qui ne vont pas être comme des cultures compagnes, ils ont beaucoup de problèmes avec le colza d'hiver d'habitude, avec les hivers très froids, avec des réchauffements brutaux. Et avec une plante compagne, ils ont beaucoup moins de problèmes. Ils ont 15%, ils réussissent leur colza, ils vont bien rendre 15%.
And then this is wheat, but this is high protein wheat that usually requires a lot of nitrogen. This is your chickpeas again, your pois chiche, and I grew them together. In this case, it's a companion, no harvesting of the pois chiche. But I didn't use any herbicides, I didn't use any fertilizer, and I grew the same, I had the same yield as everybody else in the neighborhood. So I made more money.
Okay, donc en fait, elle utilise le pois chiche comme plante compagne d'un blé qui va être très riche en protéines. Donc le pois chiche ne va pas être récolté, mais vu qu'elle utilise pas du tout d'azote et moins de produits phytosanitaires en autre, elle va, et qu'elle a les mêmes rendements sur ses parcelles que les voisins, elle va faire plus de bénéfices sur sa parcelle que les voisins.
And then this is what we were talking about before, Féverol and blé dur. And you can see that the beautiful nitrogen fixation. Féverol puts so much nitrogen in the ground. It's wonderful, it has deep roots. We grew the best germ wheat that we've seen, and we just didn't grow enough Féverol.
Sorry, but how do you clean up?
How do we clean up?
Yes.
We harvested them together. So we harvested the wheat and the beans together.
During growing.
We had no, we didn't, we can't use any fertilizer, I mean any herbicides. So we did it.
It's clean.
Je crois que les densités sont telles qu'il n'y a pas grand chose qui pousse de chemin.
No, it's clean. It's very clean. That's the whole point of this, though. The reason I'm showing you this is because the whole point of this is you can't use a herbicide, nor do I want to. The whole point of this is to grow so many plants I don't get weeds.
But you need a club when the bigger
do I? No, I don't think so. I mean, in this farm, Axton farms are, you know, 4,000 hectare. So that's big machinery. But I do it on 70 hectares, and with smaller machinery, and it works fine.
But there are not advantages.
There are what?
Advantages.
No, I don't. No, I don't.
Well, if there are, just if there are.
Yeah, they might be as big. But they're underneath the canopy.
L'objectif en gros c'est d'avoir une telle densité de plantes que rien
pousse. I know.
And do you purchase the side and the
We put some fertilizer with the meat at the blay.
On the line?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, but not after that, no. And then this is in mice. So this is pigeon pea in mice, and I don't know how you. That's a tropical legume. We put pigeon pea in with the mice. We did guar, and guar translates guar, and then mung beans. And we put them between the rows too. And then this is the harvest. So Three Sisters is maize, haricot, and courge. This is maize and guar, maize and pigeon pea, maize and sun hemp, maize and cowpeas, and maize and mung beans. Now remember we talked about before that maize is a tropical plant, so we use tropical legumes.
Alors, j'ai pas tout compris les différentes espèces, mais du coup, ça retombe sur le fait qu'il faut mettre des espèces tropicales avec des espèces tropicales, et c'est pas mélanger les torchons et les sardines.
So, this is traditional corn here, grown in a traditional way. This is our Three Sisters corn, and we're going to look at this number here, which is zinc, and we're going to look at calcium, and you can see that the Three Sisters did very well. We yielded very well, and we got good nutrition. We come down, this is pigeon pea and sun hemp. Sun hemp yielded less, so we had more nutrition in it, but the pigeon pea did very well. So what we look at is, we're looking at the cowpeas and the pigeon pea now, and we're mixing them together, and then that's going in this year.
So this is the composition of the plant after the harvest?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, after the harvest. So this is the corn itself.
Donc en fait c'est les mêmes mélanges sur la photo d'avant, sauf que là on voit pas la taille de l'épi, on voit la composition et chimique du coup de cet épi, la qualité nutritionnelle de l'épi, et on retrouve plus ou moins les mêmes têtes de liste, les bons mélanges visuellement pour être aussi les bons mélanges niveau composition.
And we didn't with the sun hemp, the deer really liked it. So we're mixing this one, and this one together now so that the deer won't eat the same here.
Donc ils ont eu des soucis, oui, les cervidés qui ont fait pas mal de tonte dans les cultures associées, donc maintenant ils font des mélanges de cultures associées pour éviter d'avoir...
So,
on vient de chercher le TGP, juste pour la traduction, c'est la croix d'Angole.
Ok. All right. So, this is why we do the covers. These are all the reasons why you do what we've been talking about. And I think that's pretty obvious. Genetics are important. And this is P genetic. This is different varieties, 483 different P varieties. And we screen them for iron, zinc, manganese, and copper. And you can see that they varied a lot.
Ces différentes variétés de pois, et entre les différentes variétés, il y a beaucoup de diversité au niveau des teneurs en fer, zinc, manganèse.
And so my point here is that we need to select. So we talked today about quality and how important quality is, nutrient quality. Then we need to choose the right plants